Good noon, everybody. Greetings from Akanksha Hospital and Research Institute. This is Dr. Naina Patel. First of all, I would like to thank CIPLA for arranging this webinar, wherein we are going to talk on a very critical subject, which is analyzing and managing patients with negative IVF outcomes. For more than four decades, the IVF success rate, which was in less than one digit person success rate, has now gone higher. And there are a number of IVF centers which are coming up all over the world. Since the birth of Louis Brown, we have seen millions of babies being born, but still the success rate is not more than 36% on an average. Excuse me, there is a little technical error. We'll just cover it up soon. So when a couple gets a negative outcome, the first reaction is they are upset, frustrated, and they start blaming themselves, maybe one another. They start blaming the doctor. It's equally distressful for the doctor also, because the doctor also feels that where did we go wrong? What different we could have done to give a positive outcome? The Indian scenario is such that we cannot wait for recurrent implantation failure, because most of our patients pay out of their pocket. And therefore, when the patients are paying from their pocket, we are really trying hard to give each and everyone a success with the first cycle itself. So analyzing critically the first cycle is very, very essential when we are looking at the negative outcome of IVF treatment. Success rate can vary from few percentage in advanced age females to even 60-70% when we are using donor gametes in the form of donor eggs, sperm or embryo. There are lots of questions which a couple can ask, and with the Google doctor around, many a times you are fired with a list of questions that why did you transfer if the aligning was less than 7 millimeter? You had told us that this embryo is not of the excellent quality. You should not have immunological factors, the natural killer cells, the T helper 1 and TH2 cells, their ratio, and the TNF alpha level is also important. There is an agreement that elevated level of TH1 cells are associated with rejection of embryos, and TH2 cells elevated are associated with pregnancy and can be measured with cytokine. Hereditary thrombophilia is one factor you can look, but that is with repeated failures, and chronic endometritis. Even with one negative result, evaluate the patient for the chronic endometritis, which causes the bacterial colonization, and surprisingly, these patients may not have symptoms. Genetics, the chromosomal abnormalities, including the translocations, mosaicisms, inversion, and deletion, should be looked into. So let us start that the patient, you had expected a positive result, everything went off well, but still there is a negative outcome. What next? The analysis, what went right, what went wrong, what are the lessons learned, what needs to change, to be changed. It cannot be answered only by the clinician. The whole team, starting from the nurse who was administering the injections or who packed the injection, to the embryologist, to the egg retrieval procedure, to the embryo transfer procedure, and the laboratory parameters. So our team sits together with the embryologist and the doctor first to discuss that what was the quality of eggs, sperm, embryo, what went wrong, and then with the couple to find out that from the couple's point also, anything that could have gone wrong. Listen to your couple patiently, because sometimes when they give the history, you can find out a clue. Our protocol at the center is to analyze the outcome of the cycle on the day the embryo transfer is done. Yes. When the embryo transfer is done, we first look at the embryo quality, day 3 or blastocyst, what was the grade. For that embryo quality, that day itself, we analyze the stimulation protocol. We all know that we may go wrong in the first cycle in the stimulation. Maybe we could have used some different protocol. We'll discuss that later. Then the sperm quality and parameter. And after that, what was the outcome of the blastocyst and embryos? look at the uterine receptivity on the day of transfer, because you have just done it, you would know that what is the lining, blood flow, texture, was there anything wrong there? Was the procedure smooth? We could have used a different catheter. Was it difficult? There was some internal loss obstruction. Then the patient profile, what it is like and what result we should be expecting. And finally, the lab parameter. How were the other patient's embryos doing on the same day? And then we give a percentage of success. Supposing this patient was to get a 40% success, yes, we have done everything correct to get that 40%. Or yes, this patient was a donor and we had expected 60, but we went wrong in the transfer, or the lining was not what we expected, or the blastocyst is not the quality that we expected, and we give a percentage. That helps you when the outcome is there, or after 2 weeks when you get the result positive or negative. As soon as you get negative result, there is a paper in your case paper which has said that on the day of transfer, you had looked at all these parameters and you found that these things could be changed, or these things could be done differently, or prior next cycle, we'll have to make these many changes, which could be in the egg, in the sperm, in the uterus, in the lab, etc. So now we will discuss the therapeutic intervention for optimal IVF treatment. As I said, the holistic approach is the best. Don't rush to do a back-to-back cycle. Give a break to your patient, which is much needed. You have a thought process. You have written everything that, okay, this patient will need a hysteroscopy before we do it. The cervix was tightly stenosed. Maybe we need to rule out tuberculosis. Maybe the stimulation is to be changed. In that 2 months' time, again, advise your patient to go for this lifestyle changes. I had a couple from Dubai who were trying to set up an IT center in Hong Kong. So on the way, they used to jump into Anand to do an IVF cycle. We got good eggs, but none of the embryos reached blastocyst. And they were really upset that in Dubai, our 2 cycles, we always got a blastocyst. What went wrong? In the history, I found out they were on junk food, no exercise, no proper sleeping patterns. And all the time, they were stressed about setting up their IVF center in Hong Kong. There was the reason. 2 months, I said, stop everything. Just lead a healthy lifestyle. 3 months, they did that. They came back again. They have twins. The quality of the eggs and embryos were excellent. So what is going wrong? You can see the stimulation protocol. Individualized controlled ovarian stimulation. There is nothing like a blanket stimulation for everybody. And the day you do the retrieval and do the transfer, you know on the day of retrieval that, yes, this patient, I was expecting 12 eggs, but with this antagonist protocol, I got just 4 or 5. Maybe I delayed starting the stimulation. Maybe this patient is a better candidate for long agonist protocol or a pre-treatment with birth control pill, because we need a synchronized cohort of the eggs to get good quality and number of eggs. Maybe in a PCOS patient, I had hyperstimulated the patient and therefore from 6 days, I reduced the dosage and I ended getting less eggs. The embryologist will immediately shout, the eggs are vacuolated, granulated, not very good, overmature. Maybe you gave your trigger a day too late and the eggs had gone overmature. They were granulated. Or the embryologist will say, there are 20 eggs, I need to do ICSI, but all of them look like GV. And she starts stripping and there are GV, not M1, M2. So there you could have delayed giving the trigger by 2 days. This analysis is done on the day of egg retrieval itself. And this will help you write down in the case paper of the patient that the next cycle, if it fails, I will be doing this, and that could help the patient. Agonist, antagonist, longer duration, milder stimulation, and then increase. Or you were too mild on an obese patient and she's showing just 2 or 3 eggs. You need to give a higher stimulation the next cycle. So ovulation induction is definitely important. A meta-analysis has shown that each patient should be individually stimulated. For poor responders, this is the biggest worry, because they only cycle for money for 1 cycle and you want to do the best for them. So in the poor responder, you can start with HMG, you can start with FSH plus LH, or there is a protocol called ACUVIT, accumulation of vitrified embryos. We do this from day 2 or 3, you start the oral ovulogens in the form of clomiphene. From 7th, 8th day, you add the HMG. Just 1 antagonist needed, a trigger, maybe sometimes a double trigger, dual trigger is also needed. When you get less mature oocytes in those patients, the trigger can be dual HCG plus GnRH agonist can be given. Changing the protocol in these patients, finally, if the patient insists on going for her eggs, give them the ovarian rejuvenation with the therapy, and ultimately, if you feel that nothing is going to help donor eggs. Acuvit, more of tablets, less of injection. Endro IVF protocol is very good for poor responders, where you give in the previous month bi-weekly HCG injections of 2,500. You start with the androgen, you start with the coenzymes, and then from day 25, you start with the estradiol tablets, and once the period starts, you give the HMG protocol to this patient or recombinant FSH plus LH. This is very interesting, and now I'm a big proponent of this because we have an experience of almost 3.5 years. The human ovary in the cortex has got the presumable site of the ovarian stem cell location. You cannot increase drastically the number, but you can definitely improve the quality of the eggs, and number of papers and studies are there. The inclusion criteria for ovarian rejuvenation would be normal karyotype and age 23 to 40, maximum 45. But you should rule out hypothalamic cause, autoimmune disease, malignancy, and abnormal karyotyping. The methods is blood, platelet-rich plasma, but I'm still bone marrow-derived stem cell concentrate is ideal. And you can instill it transvaginally by ultrasound, but laparoscopy is again better because you can directly go to the hilum of the ovary and where the blood flow is going and inject into the cortex. We have a study of 102 patients, two were for reversal of menopause, but out of the remaining patients, we have 24 results. And this was the first patient, both of them homeopathic doctor, who agreed because the AMH was 0.3. After doing it, she just conceived with IUI and the next pregnancy was natural conception. This couple from the US had 0.95 AMH. The first cycle we tried, both the cycles, there were 2P and a rest. We suggested ovarian rejuvenation in July. She comes back again, we do her cycle, and she delivered a healthy baby. This couple from UK had heard about ovarian rejuvenation being done at my place. They had two cycles in UK where both 2P and a rest. Surprisingly, her AMH was not bad, 1.56. But in the UK, they advised donor eggs. So they came to me, we did a laparoscopic ovarian rejuvenation, and she conceived naturally in the month of March and already has delivered a healthy baby. Good. There are a number of lab procedures also which can help you analyze how we can improve it the next step. And one of them is the embryo co-culture. If you think that your fertilization and the embryo was not going up to mark, you can use this technique. The egg, when you retrieve it, the cumulus cells are separated, teased, and then they are incubated. 2 to 3 hours you incubate before ICSI, and by the time it gets settled, and then when you do the ICSI, after doing ICSI, you put the fertilized egg to grow on this feeder layer of the own cumulus cells. And these are the pictures of the co-culture of the cumulus cells at our center, and you get lovely blastocyst in patients where you feel that more growth factors. And therefore, this co-culture is an advanced IVF technique to promote embryo development as a mimic natural environment. You need a little more of resources, little more of patients, and little more of the embryologist workload will be increased. But before doing the second cycle, if your finding was the egg was good, sperm was good, but the fertilization has gone somewhere low, you can try this. Now we come to the uterus. Even in the laboratory procedures, you can improve by doing a laser assisted hatching next time, aiding it if you feel that the zona is really thick of that particular egg or the embryo. And I've seen this in young patients, also not the advanced age, so it's a little bit help. Male factor we'll discuss later. Now let us look at the uterus. A good 3D vaginal ultrasound before you take up the next cycle. Hysteroscopy, we know that we don't promote pre-IVF hysteroscopy in all the patients because of the resources, because of the cost factor. But yes, one negative cycle, and there is a little doubt also, better do a hysteroscopy. Putting the scope seeing inside is definitely good. Maybe a fresh cycle was done, think of the frozen thought cycle. Endometrial injury, controversial, but studies are there. Intrauterine perfusion of GCSF is good. These are quite common, but what we prefer is another two or three important things that I mentioned. One is peripheral blood mononuclear cells. I'll tell you how we do it. Endometrial PRP with autologous blood, and bone marrow derived stem cells for thin endometrium. That is the last resort for recurrent implantation failure. What is this? GCSF, we know that 2 days to maximum 8 days before the IUI or embryo transfer, you can instill it like an intrauterine instillation, and about 0.5 cc can go inside the uterus, and that helps in getting a positive outcome, making the endometrium more receptive. Peripheral blood mononuclear cells, which is the lymphocyte activation, whenever there is one or two failures, we think that the endometrium is not doing justice, it is going barely up to 8 mm, maybe the blood flow we are not happy with, or the consistency we are not happy with, then we do this. Or when the patient has had a myomectomy and a scarred endometrium, submucous myoma, polyp removal, or previous DNCs and the endometrium is scarred or patchy, we would like to do for this. Patient's autologous blood is taken. From there, the blood mesenchymal cells are taken out, and after 2 days activating it, we inject it, instill it inside the uterus. Twice we do it, 2 days before embryo transfer and 8 days before embryo transfer. 50 cases will be coming out with the study soon. GCSF also helps. Endometrial PRP is the platelet-rich plasma. 20 ml blood of the patient is taken. The plasma, platelet-rich plasma, is prepared and activated, and then immediately within 15 minutes is instilled inside the uterus. This is a rare case, but it's interesting. So I'm saying a patient with 3 failed cycles because of the thin endometrium and was refused IVF everywhere and had to go, was advised surrogacy, but they didn't want to go, they couldn't afford it also. So we did 3 pilot cases of endometrial rejuvenation, endometrial stem cell therapy. We were inspired by Carlos Siemens' study, where they had done the blood stem cells they had taken after mobilizing it from the bone marrow. And from that, they had taken out the CD133 and injected into the spiral arterioles. So from that study, we got inspired and we made a simpler version of it. We took the bone marrow from the iliac crest. We prepared it for in 1 hour and 15 minutes. We did not passage or treat it chemically. But this was in the cath lab that we have by the interventional cardiologist, or a radiologist can also do, from the femoral artery of both the sides. We go to the opposite side iliac, go to the uterine artery, and then with the micro-NGO catheters, we instill it directly into the spiral arterioles. And this patient, after 3 months, this is the setup that we have. We could see that the lining, which was very, very thin, went up to 7 mm. After starting progesterone, again dropped to 6. And when we transferred the second time in May, she conceived and she delivered healthy baby boy without any obstetric complications. So this is the first case in India where bone marrow derived stem cell concentrate were directly injected into the spiral arterioles for the endometrial thickness to improve. The other is the ENA test, that is the endometrial receptivity assay. We know that implantation is a crosstalk between the embryo and endometrium, and different factors, from growth factors, cytokines, cell adhesion, molecule scan, transcription factors, are important for this implantation window, which is only for a few days, which can start any time after 6 days of ovulation. So ERA test is where you give the patient repeated failures 2 times, and you give the patient the estradiol tablet to develop the lining to 8 mm. Then you start the progesterone, noting the exact time when you have started the progesterone. And then after 5 days of progesterone, you do the endometrial biopsy. Along with hysteroscopy, we do it and exactly note what time, 12 o'clock in the noon, 1 o'clock, when the biopsy has been taken. And you send it for the analysis, and you'll give the result that the progesterone exposure was less, more, or by number of hours also, they will find out. So this is one test we use, but with repeated failure, not with one. Male factor is equally important. MC, DFI, testicular rejuvenation, TSA, and donor sperms. The DNA fragmentation index is very, very important to get the to know what is the sperm quality. It is not just the count and the number. We had this first one patient from Nankleshwar, which has got very high chemical pollutants. Count was good, motility was good. We did an IVF, young patient, and to our surprise, fertilization was not there. What went wrong? That time in 2014, we found out that let us do the DFI for this patient because of the exposure to chemical pollutants, and we found out that the DFI fragmentation was on the highest side. We treated the patient with antioxidants, lifestyle changes, healthy lifestyle, and then it came down to 13 and we got lovely embryos. So this is how we report the DNA fragmentation index. And to treat the DNA fragmentation index, there is a sperm washing technique, like we do swim-up gradient, density gradient. This is magnetic activated cell sorting, wherein the non-apoptotic spermatozoa will be separated from apoptotic, and therefore you can use the best spermatozoa with the least DNA fragmentation, and you can do the ICSI. Very good for poor embryo quality or failed fertilization. You have seen subject if the male partner is diabetic, obese, and history of smoking and tobacco, definitely go for the DNA fragmentation test before you jump onto the next IVF cycle. And therefore, this is how the setup of NET is there at our hospital. Direct aspiration of the testicular sperms, which is also good, and fresh sperms are better than frozen. Whenever you feel that when the ejaculated sperms are giving low result or DFI is not getting properly treated, even after magnetic sorting, you see a 40%. It's better that we go ahead and aspirate the testicular sperms, because ejaculated sperms have a higher DNA fragmentation index than the testicular sperms. So taking the testicular sperms is a good option. Testicular rejuvenation, which we have done after getting inspired by the ovarian rejuvenation, this patient, we were using donor egg, but severe oligoasthenosispermia, and there was no blastocyst that reaches from day 3 to day 5. And we know that the paternal genome gets activated from day 3. Your patients, when they give good embryos till day 3, and day 5 you see no blastocyst. You feel the lab parameter is wrong. What has got wrong? You blame the egg? No. See the sperm, because the paternal genome gets activated day 3 of the embryos. So day 3 to day 5, you have to also look at the male parameter. Here we did the testicular rejuvenation, bone marrow autologous was taken and injected in both the testes. 3 months later, we got two beautiful blastocyst, healthy baby was delivered. This couple from Surat, number of eggs, young patient, young wife. So history of tobacco chewing and unhealthy lifestyle, everything arrested 2 p.m. We did the DFI 61%. And we did the testicular rejuvenation. And again in December, we did a cycle. Day 3 healthy embryos were transferred and baby delivered. So these are the cases that we do. Now we look at the embryonic factor. Day 3 versus day 5. So if your negative result has come on day 5 or day 3, what difference you will do? Differently you will do next time. Definitely if there is a female who has low number of eggs, low AMH or a male parameter, and on day 5 you don't get any embryos, it is better next time to go for a day 3 transfer. And if vice versa, you have done a day 3 transfer and not waited till day 5, and you have the frozen embryos of day 3, it is better the next time you advise the patient that let us see if your embryos reach outside to day 5. It's always good for the embryos to be inside because it gets a natural environment. But if it doesn't reach day 5 outside, there are chances that it can stop growing inside. Then whether to change the protocol of fresh versus frozen. Definitely, we look at both these aspects. Pregnancy perinatal outcomes after first blastocyst and day 3, they found that blastocyst had a better outcome. Though extended embryo culture, if your lab is not good, may give a lower embryo or blastocyst formation. So that has to be very importantly seen. Fresh versus frozen, this is a big study by Sandro Esteves, and they have found out that there was a significant increase in live birth rate with single embryo transfer, which are frozen rather than the fresh. And world over, we are moving toward frozen, but I still insist, when you have less number of eggs, when you think that after the retrieval, you see that the endometrial lining is good, it is not progesteronized, the progesterone level has been always less than 1.5. And the patient is willing, we can go for a day 3 transfer. At our centers, 40% of the cycles are still fresh embryo transfer and the eggs are retrieved in the same cycle, because ultimately the epigenetic effect of the vitrification, etc., is still a question mark. Look at the lab. What is the fertilization rate? One particular patient has low or the other patients also has low. What is the quality of the embryo? All the embryos are going wrong. Did your person in the lab say there was some issue with the gas? It had dropped down, an alarm was going on. or you can find in the culture that there is some infection. So all this quality control is very, very important. And the KPI for embryology, this is the bare minimum. There is a big list, but media details, laboratory QA/QC, their equipment, instrumentation, AMC, number of oocytes, number of M1, M2, GV, fertilization rate, fresh frozen, 2PN stage, good quality embryos, blastulation formation is very, very important KPI. Number of embryo transfer, how many reach for PGT testing, rate of frozen thawed blastocyst when you see the survival rate. And these are the important parameters in the lab which you should always you should discuss with your embryologist. The most important is the embryo transfer procedure. What happened when you get that transfer? Many a times a busy gynec IVF specialist and maybe an obstetrician also at the same time, lab surgeon is called in the OPD and the embryo transfer because it's the easiest to go, boom, put the embryo and come out. No. Be very quiet. Your mind should be focused on this procedure because it is the end result of the effort of almost 2 months of consultation, medication for the patient, for the couple, for the doctor, and for the embryologist. Ultrasound, half full bladder, see where exactly you want to put. Always do a mock transfer. Find out which catheter will be suitable. Pinhole, maybe you need a solid catheter, which is straight. Maybe you need a curved catheter. And if there is cervical infection, treat that. When you are taking the patient in a frozen thawed cycle, always on day 7 or day 8 or 10 when she comes, check again for infection and see that there is no infection and then do the transfer and note each and every point, good transfer, bad transfer, blood, no blood, etc. This will also help you to find out. So embryo transfer should be the last process of the day with a very calm and cool mind. Luteal phase support is also important. On an average, people have come to conclusion that vaginal versus intramuscular has no difference. But yes, in a frozen thawed embryonic cycle, when you are taking on HRT replacement, I would suggest in a natural cycle, vaginal is fine. But in a HRT cycle, maybe alternate day or twice a week shots of intramuscular injection of progesterone is important. PGT-A and PGT-M, which is very important protocol, which will help the advanced maternal age, repeated failures, idiopathic recurrent miscarriage, severe male factor. In one cycle, if you feel that, because we have patients who are 40 plus giving 4 good blastocysts, 4AA, but when you do the PGT-A, it turns out to be that most of them are abnormal. So this is one important technique. And it has found out that definitely the live birth rates have improved and time to conception has reduced. At our center, since 2014 to August 29, the latest statistics that we have not done so far, 1,477 embryos biopsied, and out of that, more than 50% were abnormal, 779. And the 38% success rate were in patients with recurrent failure, severe male factor, multiple miscarriages, and advanced maternal age. We also do a lot of PGD, that is PGTM. We have successfully done the albinism case, which could be second or third in the world, from an African patient who had a surprisingly albino baby. And both of them were normal, but they were carrier, heterozygous carrier of one mutant, which was homozygous for the baby, COL4A1, thalassemia major, Jacobs syndrome, polycystic kidney disease. Again, we have done successfully reciprocal translocation balanced, and now in the process, spinal muscular atrophy. Immunotherapy. There are so many therapies available. Some find it wasteful, some find it useful. No concrete studies. IVIG for IVF failure, 30 gram you give at the time of embryo transfer and repeat it when the heartbeat is seen, which has a good impact on the Th T1 cells. T2 cells are increasing. And intralipid is what we routinely do for one failure after that. 8 days before embryo transfer, on the day of embryo transfer, and 1 week later after embryo transfer, and intralipid has been showing some promising results, which is 250 ml that we give it. Antibiotics for infection. Chronic endometritis, I would really like to emphasize on this. Ultrasound, maybe polyps, but you go hysteroscopy, hyperemic, there are micro polyps inside. And these are the patients, and especially PCO patients also show very thickened endometrium at that time. This chronic endometritis, first of all, I missed out the doxycycline daily, morning, evening for 14 days, metronidazole, prednisolone, and we give vaginal capsules, the Ivanu, probiotic basically for 15 days to clear up that. And there are tests available, but we don't go for this expensive culture test, but we just rule out and then we go ahead and do the transfer. Any intrauterine pathologies which you had doubted is there, but you have not removed, like a fibroid which was impinging but you thought has not affected, but second time before transfer you can counsel the patient, salpingectomy, endometrial injury. Patient, before you start the cycle, should be thoroughly counseled, educated. It is a draining and stressful, but by the time you start the first cycle and finish the first cycle, plan B should be ready for you. And give the real expectation to the patient. Don't say a guaranteed 100% you will get it, you are young. Yes, give a positive counseling, but prepare them from negative. Proper counseling, proper documentation. Many a times we don't see the embryo pictures also. We don't see what injection protocol was used also. How do we decide that in next cycle what better we do? That all should be documented. Evaluate the total cycle on the day of transfer, because it's very fresh at that time that what could have gone wrong. Re-evaluate with your team, counsel and discuss with the patients. Be very empathetic. I feel that there are doctors who would meet the positive but not meet the negative. Positive outcome you may not meet, your assistant can meet, but negative outcome needs you. Do a counseling, do a hand-holding, sympathize with her, give her the real picture. Maybe your egg will not work, we go with donor, whatever. Maybe you don't tell that day, tell her that you have a hope to get a result. Come after next month, we'll discuss again when she'll be in a better frame of mind to accept what you are saying. Customized IVF protocol, customized embryology procedure, customized embryo transfer, and customized uterine support will be the best approach for the next cycle. Don't go on repeating what you have done before. Thank you very much, and thanks again, Sikla, for this session. I can answer any questions that can come up now. I've already got one question, that how do you counsel a patient when you see a poor quality embryo for the transfer? So, poor quality, we have to grade it. Sometimes we have seen that 3BB blastocyst or a C grade or D grade embryo also has given a result. So we can tell the patient that your embryo quality ideally is 4AA or on day 3 it's A, but this is C. So chances of what success we had promised, like 35%, gets reduced to 30% or 25%. But it's not a no-no. We have seen a result with 30% with a grade E embryo also. So it's your choice. You can go ahead and get the transfer done. Maybe if you are lucky, you get a result. But otherwise, it's not an accident, but a transferable embryo. Ashima Sood, I didn't understand your question. I'm a gynecologist from Punjab. Preeti Upadhyay, yes, from Korba. Whether blood on outer or inner catheter always associated with poor outcome? Outer catheter, not at all. But inner catheter plus one, plus two is what the grade we give. And chances definitely drop when you see blood inside the catheter. But up to plus two, you can get a result. But why did you get that blood inside the catheter is important to analyze that very day, whether it was while you were negotiating through the internal loss or whether you have injured the endometrium at the time of transfer. Measure it, that what is the level that your the catheter had gone and what you should do next time. Now, difficult transfer, see that if your hysteroscopy has not done, do it. Internal losses, don't dilate it, just cut it so that it's permanently opened up for an easy transfer. Do a mock transfer next time. If it's easy, then only you go ahead. And for mock transfer, you can use your ETO, ET transfer catheter itself under ultrasound guidance with the full bladder, so you know that exactly you are where you are going and how you are putting it. Chamila Vai, can view, thank you. Okay, Chamila, nice to have you here. Kushwin Bath from Ludhiana. Where do you give trigger of HCG and GnRH agonist trigger? Yes, a very good question. Previously, we were giving GnRH agonist to hyperstimulated patients only and HCG to patients who were normal or poor responders. Now, as a protocol for poor responders, we have started giving both at the same time. There are protocols where you give it 40 hours before the GnRH agonist and 36 hours before you give the HCG. But when the first cycle, the patient has got less number of M2 mature oocytes or more of empty follicles, that is the time definitely in the next cycle you note down that both the injections should be given 34 to 36 hours before. But in poor responders, when you give both, you see to it that your egg retrieval happens by 33 hours to maximum 34 hours. Do not delay it. So normal responders, we have started giving both. We give the HCG full dose and the GnRH agonist 0.1, not the full dose. Preeti Upadhyay again, uterine artery PI is important to measure before giving trigger roadside before giving trigger when you are doing a frozen embryo transfer. Yes, we do look at it now and we are finding it useful. When we are doing a frozen embryo transfer, natural cycle is the best that we have seen. Allow the follicle to grow, give the HCG trigger, modified natural, and then call the patient after 36 hours and start the progesterone as you are starting and do the transfer 3 days later for day three and 5 days later for blastocyst. If you are doing a full-fledged HRT without down regulation and the patient is young, ovulating and has a shorter cycle, try to call her on 7th or 8th day and see the lining. See, because the patients may have a recruitment of the follicle earlier and that follicle can grow and ovulate and the progesterone of the progesterone level starts increasing. So in these patients, call them on day 6, 7, evaluate the lining, see the follicle. Never just concentrate on the uterus, see the follicle also. And for such patient, best is a down-regulated cycle. When we see the endometrium is 8 mm plus, we see the subendometrial blood flow and we see the uterine artery PI and RI less than 1 and less than 3, which is important parameter that we have started. We also do the estradiol and the progesterone level. We prefer a progesterone level of less than 0.5 when we start the progesterone injections, but up to 1.5 we go. But we have seen that more than 1, the results do get compromised. I should go slow, Hashima. I'm so sorry. There is Dr. Deshmukh who has asked about testicular rejuvenation. So testicular rejuvenation is very important for severe oligoastenospermia patients. And there are studies where they have done also on esospermic mice. This study is very important where they give busulfan to make the mice esospermic, and once the esospermia was confirmed, they injected the bone marrow derived stem cell concentrate in the testes of one side and not on the other side, and they found that spermatogenesis was seen when this was injected in the side where the bone marrow derived concentrates were injected. So this has inspired many a studies, and now what we are doing is we are taking the bone marrow from the iliac crest. Then within 1 hour to 1 hour and 15 minutes when the cells are separated, we inject them in the testes. It depends on the size of the testes. You cannot go like ovary 1 ml, 2 ml. You have to keep filling the testes. You go a little bit beneath the skin of the scrotum. Then you go in the center, top, below. Try to feel the turgidity, and if it starts getting harder, you stop even at 0.4 mm. But if it is a bigger size, you can go even up to 0.751 mm. It should not become stone hard, then it can undergo necrosis. So injecting it is very, very critical and very smart. Nicely, you should evaluate, slowly inject it and find out the pressure in the testes and then stop. So this is the process we do for testicular rejuvenation. Monica Singh, what is your HMG preparation of choice? Do you believe in preparations with endogenous HCG activity? Yes, HMG preparation is very rarely that we take. When we are seeing a patient whose lining is not developing well in a natural cycle and the follicle is growing, but it is not going beyond 14, 15, we give HMG injection 75 IU, very rarely 150 IU for 2 or 3 days, evaluate again, and then we give the trigger of HCG. In a very good follicle that is single developed, we just give away HCG, and endogenous progesterone and endogenous HCG is better. That's the experience we have, but world over they have said that down-regulated with HRT, only HRT or natural cycle have seen the results. In natural cycle, the cancellation rate is higher because maybe she has ovulated earlier than you expected and therefore the window goes she gets progesteronized earlier. So that is one thing that you should keep in mind, that when you are doing a natural cycle with endogenous HCG, try to call patient frequently. Peripheral mononuclear therapy, it's a very good, which we got it from ASHRAE, which was in Geneva, where they had done a study on mice. And this study was very interesting, it's still available, where they had taken this blood and separated the mononuclear cells, the lymphocytes, and these were then activated. We put it in the refrigerator, then activated, and 2 days later we transfer it. We put it intrauterine instillation. Twice we do it, and we can give you the details. You can send me your email and I will send you the details how we do it, and you can follow that. Dr. Preeti Upadhyay from Korba, PRP, when to be done? The ideal time of doing PRP is 2 to 8 days before, not before that. If you have done it 8 days before, you might have to repeat it, because the maximum effect is for these many days. 2 to 8 days before embryo transfer, we do the endometrial PRP. And the activation is very important. Whether you use calcium, we use the cold and the heat therapy. We put it at minus 196 degrees, immediately remove it in 15 seconds, and then within 15 minutes that has to be installed inside the uterus. It cannot keep on roaming around for 1 hour. The potential is maximum for that 15 minutes. Deshmukh, again, you send me the details. I'll send you how we prepare the peripheral mononuclear therapy, and I'll give you the reference from where we started it. What's about ERA? Yes, in selected patients we do ERA, but not with one failure cycle unless the patient is very, very impressive. In a repeated implantation failure with good quality PGS normal embryo where we feel the result would have been there, we go for ERA test. And ERA test, previously we used to get the report receptive, but now we do get a result that it's 12 hours later, 12 hours early, or 24 hours earlier. And that is how we plan our progesterone shots, based on the time we do want to do the transfer. Do you give stem cell therapy training? We have not yet started, but if you want, yes, we can think it over and we can give it to you. Surely we can give you. Lovely talk, ma'am. How can we prepare from peripheral blood? You have to take the ACDA, the sample which is there in the blood collection. So we get these ACDA bags, and these bags, you take 2 ml from that and 20 ml of patient's blood. It is spinned twice, 1500 and then 1200, the exact methodology I send you. And once it is done, it is allowed to stand. And then once the patient is taken in the lab, OT, for endometrial or ovarian, that is the time we just activate it. Because the activation, within 15 minutes, as I said, we have to install it. So you have to be very prepared. And that minus 196 degrees, we dip it inside and then we remove it, allow it to stay again at room temperature, and then we install inside the uterus or the ovary. Fluid at that time of ET or 2-3 days prior to ET? Yes, very good question. Fluid is one of the reasons that can give negative results. Reason for the fluid could be, it could be simple, the cervical secretions have gone up, or it could be because of tuberculosis or any endometrial infection which the patient could have. There are patients when there is high estradiol also can show. Somehow the cabergoline tablet has worked. Antibiotic should be started in the form of doxycycline and metrogel. If the embryos are excellent quality, and the patient is not in a hurry, I would say that I would not want to transfer in this cycle. We also aspirate it 2 days before it is there and call again on the day of embryo transfer and see. Even at the time of embryo transfer, we have aspirated, but the cycle gets compromised, result goes down. So if it's a patient who already has a negative outcome, I would ask her to defer it to the next cycle. Role and dose of filgrastim, not very big proponent, but yes, in thin endometrium, we do use it, but use it from as soon as she finishes her periods, 3 times intravaginally. GCSF, yes, we have been using it, and now we are not using it because we are more going towards endometrial PRP. But GCSF, on the day of egg retrieval, when we are doing the fresh transfer, or if we are doing a frozen transfer, again, as I said, maximum 2 to 8 days before we instill it inside the uterus. Sheetal, you have asked about embryo glue in RIF. We had used it previously in a big number, but our studies, we were not happy with it. Now we do have the facility for embryo glue, but it's only on patient's demand. When a Google doctor comes and says, I want embryo glue, I use it, but I don't see a difference in the result. How will you treat if there is free fluid in endometrial cavity at the time of ET? I said that I will aspirate it. If it's a first time transfer, maybe give antibiotics, give cabergoline and go ahead with the transfer. But if it's a negative outcome patient, I would like to evaluate the endometrium for chronic endometritis, tuberculosis, and then only plan the embryo transfer the next cycle, not the same one. Which catheter you use for difficult transfer? There is the straight catheter, which is the black color, I forgot the name, which is very good. That is the one we use for the difficult transfer. And it has got stilet inside. So that's very important. You push it along with the stilet. It's a black catheter. I'll give you the name. And then you remove the stilet, then you pass the catheter, and then you put it inside, and I'll send you the name, Monica. Prithvij, what is your protocol using IVIG or ultralipid? How many doses and how many days before the transfer? Prithvij, we are not using IVIG mode, but I'm a follower of this, proponent of this intralipid, which has definitely helped 8 days before transfer. If you are doing ovarian stimulation and the transfer in the same cycle, around 6th or 7th day of the stimulation. But normally in frozen, 8 days before, on the day of embryo transfer, so 1 week before, on the day, and 1 week after. If it's a positive result, there are two protocols, either 3 weekly, but if you feel the patient has history of recurrent pregnancy loss, I go weekly also with intralipid. But they say that one intralipid of 250 ml can take care of 2 to 3 weeks. And the other thing, if is you are using propofol, for anesthesia, when you are doing the egg retrieval, it has a similar component of intralipid. So that also can help at the time of egg retrieval. Nagaraj Narayan Gavati, ma'am, what all adjuvants you recommend during second IVF in unexplained infertility? Look, if the second cycle adjuvants, I would say that if it's a PCO, give 2 cycles of birth control pill with metformin and then start the second cycle. Poor responders, give the DHEA. 2 cycles with coenzymes, then start for husband-wife. Mainly CoQ300 or coenzyme tablets, DHEA, multivitamins. Vitamin D deficiency and vitamin B12 we definitely need to rule out. And diet restrictions also with the lifestyle changes. When we are doing the retrieval, post-transfer, now there are studies coming up with high levels of prednisolone. They are using the steroids up to 40 milligram a day. We don't go to that high level, but at least 10 milligram a day we give at the time post-transfer. Even we start pre-transfer in a donor egg cycle fresh. And for poor responder patients, again, accurate what I explained. Post-transfer, we go ahead and give vitamin E. We also give, if it is required, to the patients, low dose exogene fresh transfer if it's not a hyperstimulated patient. Progesterone, we check the levels. If it's a negative result, if it's low, then these patients are benefited with intramuscular injections of progesterone rather than vaginal. If you see repeated vaginal infections, better to go for intramuscular injections. So these are the different adjuvants we use. Baby aspirin, we have gone up to 150 milligram. Nowadays, we prefer 150, and low molecular weight heparin. Every day in patients who have had one failed cycle, I would suggest. More question we have. What is your percentage of FET whether it's fresh? I said that 40% of our cycles are still fresh. I have got the results over here where we have seen that self fresh cycle with the self eggs. Donor eggs, it could be fresh frozen, but with self eggs, when we do a fresh cycle, our success rate was 25.8%. But when the same patients, we did the frozen, the success rate was 43%. But the self eggs, I would say, when we have done a fresh transfer, either it was a very poor responder patient with low number of eggs and the number of embryos were less, and the lining was still good with the parameter. So these patients are already little compromised. Patient profile is not as good as self-frozen, because self-frozen, they might be having more embryos, their fresh goes wrong, and then the next time we do the frozen from the same. So this is the success rate that we have, but still we are sticking to almost 35-40% fresh. Ashima, thank you for this. What you have written, excellent presentation. Shweta, when are you doing dual trigger in normal responder? Do you still consider fresh ET or frozen ET? With dual trigger, you can go ahead and do a fresh ET. There is no restriction to frozen because you have already given HCG to the patient. If all other parameters like no hyperstimulation, progesterone level was less than 1.5 on the day of trigger, I would definitely go ahead and do a fresh transfer if the patient wants. Because patients nowadays are also themselves understand going ahead for frozen transfer. Normal responders I will give in patients where I feel that there is a dyssynchrony. You know, when you are giving the trigger dose, you are seeing right from day 5 when you call for the scan on day 6, there are 2 follicles which have gone to 14, 15, 16. The rest are lagging behind 11, 12, 9, 10. So by giving the agonist to the patient, dual trigger, what we do is there is an FSH surge, LH surge both. So the follicles that are lagging behind, you are getting good 20, 18, 19, 3 follicles. The others are 14, 15, 16, 14. And you have to give the trigger, the progesterone is rising. In those patients, normal responder also, I would prefer this dual trigger rather than single. You will find that the M2 follicles will be more and you will retrieve more eggs than when you have given just an NCG. Yes, there is a specific Aparna from Kochi. What is the PRP activation method? We generally spin it and then put it and then we remove the supernatal care and we say that this is the PRP. But that PRP should be subjected to some shock. And that shock is the cold and the heat, temperature shock. And when you give that, the growth factors get released. And that is a technique which is very important when you are using PRP. Does improve results for CBI? Yes. Not only for Chamila, this question MC, not only for OAT, oligoasthenospermia patient, but also for normospermias, because the analysis that you get is under a routine microscope. When you put the sperms, the embryologist finds that there are some abnormal more I can see, and when you magnify it 6,000 to 7,000 times in MC, you will find that it is difficult to find even 10 normal sperms. So in normal count also, if the first cycle, in spite of embryologist happy with the quality of the egg, the stimulation protocol retrieval, you see the fertilization rate is not good, go ahead and subject this patient to IMC. OAT definitely, but even in normal count, subject this patient to IMC. The catheter that we use in difficult transfer is the Black catheter, which is the company Lab CCD company, Pearl Tip Classic. Laboratory CCD is the company, Pearl Tip Classic, Black catheter for difficult transfer. There is Azaz from Anand. My one IVF cycle has failed. Azaz, I'm here in Anand, stones throw away. Please come with all your reports. And yes, when we give the reports to a patient, please make it a protocol to give what stimulation you used, how many eggs were there, fertilization rate and blastocyst picture. So that the next doctor who is going to see will have a very good idea that what went wrong and how I can improve. Or there was nothing wrong, but what different I can do. Same with donor eggs also, all the details will be given. Ashima, I'm sharing you my email address, please. Jatinder, ma'am, what is your percentage of fresh transfer cycles as compared to frozen? I said 35 to 40 are still fresh, the rest are frozen. And when we are doing surrogacy, it's definitely we prefer frozen because synchronizing a surrogate with that of the patient cycle is many a times difficult. One may be lagging behind and advancing. So as a protocol, we have made it a frozen transfer when we are doing surrogacy. Only if it's a donor egg and maybe we can adjust, we'll do it. Otherwise, it's a frozen transfer. For Preeti Upadhyay from Korba, for fresh embryo transfer, cutoff limit of progesterone is 1.5 on the day of giving the trigger. If it has gone beyond that, I will go for all freeze only. Whether day 2 progesterone and estradiol should be done? Yes, we do day 2 LH, we do A2 estradiol, and we do A2 day 2 progesterone. Day 2 progesterone less than 1.5, but 2 is okay. Estradiol level should be less than 50. Very rarely in PCO patients or poor responders, we let it go to 60. And LH, why it is important? Sometimes in PCO patients, you want to give the trigger of agonist only. And the agonist trigger, if on the day of egg retrieval, LH is less than 1, you will not get the response. The eggs will not get mature. You will not get the LH surge and the progesterone levels will not go high. In such patients, you need to compare that LH with your basal LH on day 2. If the basal LH on day 2 was also very low, that gives one indication that you should have HMG in this patient. And this patient, again, with the trigger of agonist, may not give a good outcome. So to decide the trigger and to decide the protocol what to start on day 2, LH level is very, very important. Dr. Deshmukh, agonist and HCG trigger, we give it together 34 hours before, but in patients where the cohort is very dysynchronous or in the patients in the previous cycle, we had more of GV and the same profile we are seeing now, we give 40 hours before GnRH agonist full dose and 34 hours before we give the HCG full dose. Dose is 6,500 rec HCG and 0.1 milligram of triptorelin. Yes, that is correct dose. But when we are giving only agonist, it is 0.2 milligram of triptorelin. Okay, Kalpana Ben from Jamnagar. Let to see. How nice, Kalpana Ben. Manjushri from Amravati, neutral phase support. The protocol we follow for a fresh cycle is intravaginal 400 milligram. We give the vaginal suppositories, or if we are using a gel, morning, evening, and if we are injection, we are using the daily 100. But in a fresh cycle, we do not use injections more because it's painful and the own corpus luteum is functional. So just vaginal support will be fine. And we always had dihydrogesterone twice a day, morning and evening. It's a must. It's an immunomodulator and it has definitely improved the role of implantation. Along with it, we give aspirin, we give folic acid, we give multivitamins and vitamin E also we give routinely to the patients, and 3 days of short course of antibiotic in the form of azithromycin we give. And when the transfer has been like there is some blood, etc., we try to give steroids to suppress the as an immunosuppressant. So these are the protocols. But when we do a donor egg cycle and when we do a frozen, I would prefer alternate day intramuscular a must, and alternate day vaginal tablets 3 times and dihydrogesterone morning, evening, along with all other adjuvants. And also we give low molecular weight heparin daily if the patient agrees, otherwise at least twice a week. But I feel better is daily low molecular weight heparin for one field cycle. That is one. Manjushri, for the recorded webinar, you will have to ask Sipla. And Dr. Padmaja, thank you for your appreciation. See you soon. I think we don't have any more questions. So, dear friends, it's time to log off. Thanks. Stay home. Stay safe. See you all soon once the lockdown is over.